Monday to Friday, the Baroness de Ludinghausen is one of the high priestesses of fashion in Paris. At the weekend, she flies off to another country, another name, and another life.
Come, my darling.
As Mrs. Helene Smith-Ryland, she's the down-to-earth wife of a wealthy Warwickshire landowner.
Come on, let's have a little walk. Come
By
on.
Any name, she's a millionaire.
Hello? Oui, d'accord.
Although she was born in France, Baroness Helene is descended from the mighty Stroganov family. In pre-revolutionary Russia, they owned tracts of land twice the size of Britain, controlled vast mineral wealth, and lived in huge palaces. Helene, though, was brought up in Brazil. Her father was, for many years, a prosperous businessman. The family atmosphere was completely cosmopolitan.
We always spoke sort of four languages at table when we had dinner or lunch. Russian always with my grandmother, French as a general language. Whenever we spoke anything important or that had to be precise, like a plan or a trip being organized, it was always in English. And obviously Portuguese with the servants.
In her early 20s, after an education in Brazil, the USA and Switzerland, Helene was back in her favorite city. She was working in a fashionable gift shop when Yves St Laurent came through the door.
Mr. St Laurent said to me at one point, he said, may I ask you something? Is this your voice, your normal voice, or do you have a cold? I said, no, no, this is my normal voice. Then he kept looking at me and smiling, and very sort of nice smile. And I didn't quite know why, you know, I didn't think he would look at me as a model, I wasn't quite tall enough or anything like that. And a few days later, one of his best friends, who was someone I knew very well, called me and said they want to see you, because they want you to work for them.
Today, over 20 years later, she's still working with one of the world's great dress designers. For years, she's been the directrice of the Saint Laurent Fashion House. It's her job to organize one of the highlights of the fashion year, the spring collection.
On the day of the collection, my job is to first of all see that all our clients, private clients, that are invited are seated. There's a whole protocol about the seating. And that's sometimes quite difficult because you have to seat them well, but sometimes we sort of run out of space. And that's always a bit of a nerve-wracking procedure, but that's the main thing of that particular day for me. Receiving our clients, checking the week before that they're really coming, and if they're coming alone, or with their husband, or their daughter, or a friend, and then when they arrive, greeting them. You cultivate a relationship, because I do think that people, especially the ones who travel a lot, have a tendency to go where they know somebody. It's more comfortable. It's like, you know, if you order your shoes at Lob and you can afford so, you always go back to Lob. It's like going home or going to the same hotel. It's a bit that principle. Creating an atmosphere in the house.
The customers here today are prepared to pay 10, 15, 20,000 pounds for a single item. They've been drawn here from all over the world by the main event, the show.
I'm watching as a client. I look at it and judge it and see the things which appeal more to me, and I don't think of the clients that moment. It's late in the afternoon when I might see it again that I'd start thinking of what is good for whom.
After the show, the inevitable aspiring designers who want to be seen with Yves St Laurent as a kind of good luck charm. The show, says the young man, has been magic, a great success. Much of that success has been due to Helene.
Les clientes l'adorent parce que elle ne cherche jamais à apparaître plus que les clients, si vous voulez.
Yes, of course. Fine, thank you.
But Helene's work isn't over. The day after the show, in discreet consultations, she has to advise, counsel, and persuade some of the richest women in the world to buy the new designs.
This has the little martingale.
Well, do we want to maybe we should use
we
the
should try the other one too.
I love the front of this.
Okay.
It's so classical. But perhaps the back from the other suit.
Now let's look at you, Audrey. Let's look. Jean-Marie.
I think it's a beautiful
The
look.
Thing is, either this back, we don't just sell a dress. We try to adapt everything that goes with that dress. We advise on her shoes, on the accessories that she has or not, on her hairdo, on her makeup. Look at this bag. But this is a dream bag.
What? This is wonderful.
And it's summer.
Isn't it
beautiful?
What is it
made
of?
These fine.
It's like
finest. It's the finest straw ever. Because we have about four qualities. But this is the finest. And look at the color.
Leave it to you.
We try to transform a woman and get out of her the best that woman can offer. I'd rather not have too many clients who order a lot. The average is from one to about five. That's the average thing. And then you once in a while have someone who orders much more. A suit is of an average about $20,000.
About 10,000 pounds.
So you can more or less calculate how much it could be.
And it's not unusual for somebody to spend that sort of money.
No. Thank God.
Voilà, c'est ce qu'on a fait.
My whole idea was always to have a larger range of women all over the world that are able to have the two or three or four pieces.
When she's in Paris, she drives from the fashion house to her apartment in Rue de la Pompe, just off Avenue Foch, one of the most desirable addresses in the city. Most days, customers and the occasional colourful friend drop in for drinks.
It's denim! It's denim!
It's denim,
and this is Victorian and it's really beautiful.
And look,
I've dropped it.
Now, I love the combination. You have Prince Charles...
Military tailors from Welsh and Jeffries.
Yeah.
Manolo Blahnik ski boots custom made and Jean-Paul Gaultier custom made. Isn't it beautiful?
We do care about each other's concerns outside of the House of Saint Laurent and outside of the world of high fashion and outside of the world of style. At the same time, Helene is someone who is not snobbish. She's the least snobbish person that I know. In her position, she could be a great high snob. She could be a high, high holy roller, being very grand, looking down upon people. She never does.
Andre walks into my office one day and says, "Hi, darling. How's your beautiful husband? Do you know, I'm just mean about fox hunting." I said, "John, you're coming." Yeah, everything done special in London. What's the name of that dinner?
It's Welsh and Jeffries.
Voilà.
Huntsman.
Absolutely, Huntsman, yes. Here he comes.
But not to ride, but just to spectate.
I was going to say he went just for the clothes.
Just for the clothes.
I know him.
Yes, I went just for the clothes.
I know him. He went just for the clothes.
In all this very grand and sometimes uptight and pretentious world of fashion, she is a balancing act. I mean, it's very cozy in Helene's house. You can come and have dinner in the kitchen with her alone. If you think you're about to jump out of the window because the pressures are too high in life, she runs a little sort of hospital clinic for her friends. She always has time for people and their problems.
It's not just about that suit or that ball gown or that important occasion. It's just time for people and their problems.
And he says to André and to Jerry, push.
A Mercedes, this push.
Mercedes. Push, so they're both pushing.
And both actually, dressed to the nines.
Dressed to the nines.
Robin is sitting inside this car. I'm sort of way out, gone. And as I look at them, as he finally gets out of this hole, all the mud is going straight on them.
Onto my brand new coat.
So suddenly, André, so the thing is stopped. He suddenly looks at me and he says, Helene! Look at this. I said, André, it's perfect. What do you mean it's perfect? I said, you are in England.
That's right.
And nothing would be tackier than to arrive too new.
You got
to
arrive, you're perfect.
The English half of Helene's life came about through her marriage to Robin Smith-Ryland, a wealthy landowner. Helene belongs to the Russian Orthodox Church. The ceremony took place in Paris, but they met in New York.
When this whole thing happened in New York, I didn't think of anything serious for me, because Robin was certainly, by the book, nothing I thought was right for me. He was much younger than me, which I profoundly disliked the idea. He was not working, but fox hunting and running an estate in the country. I didn't particularly like the idea of country either. I always said I was an asphalt person. He was English. That was very foreign for me. And he was married. So I said, when he started sort of making all these plans, I said rather quickly that there was no question about anything of that. And therefore, I didn't think I was hurting anyone, because it wasn't going to be anything for me. And it's then that he really decided to do everything, I suppose. And 2 months later, he was separated. And from then on, you know, it was his decision anyway. It's a very strange thing. He's the first man in my life. And being 41 when I met him, I'd had lots of men in my life. He's the first man that I considered part of what I call my tribe. He was my blood. I decided that I was going to get married in gold. The Russian church is full of icons, very gold. It was Christmas, and I've always liked gold. People start howling and shouting, saying this is impossible. So I went to see St Laurent himself, and I said, this is what I want. What do you think? He said, perfect. My aunt, Princess Metternich, she lent me her tiara, which is a beautiful tiara, a closed one, with diamonds on yellow gold. And my mother had given me a very nice diamond necklace and diamond earrings.
The status and wealth of the 500 guests would have rivaled many royal weddings.
It was Prince Michael of Greece who was my first witness. Count Tolstoy, the grandson of Leon Tolstoy. The Aga Khan. His brother, Prince Amin Aga Khan, Mrs. Ford, the widow of Henry Ford, the Taubmans who own, you know, Sotheby's, Countess Donna, I know, a lot of Russian aristocracy, a lot of English ones.
Four 400 miles away in England, fox hunting is an almost full-time occupation for Robin Smith-Ryland. He often hunts 5 days a week. In spite of their regular separation, they seem to have a very stable marriage.
She is much loved. I've never known anyone with so many friends who inspires so much respect, even by people who are afraid of her, jealous of her. She is very much loved. She has an extraordinary circle of very close friends, whereas most of us perhaps have a few friends and many acquaintances. She has many, many friends and not many acquaintances.
At the weekend, home for Helene is an estate of over 2,000 acres in Warwickshire, which have been in Robin's family for 150 years. There's even a family church built by Robin's great-great-great-aunt Louisa, who gave it to the Church of England.
I was brought up religiously. I'm a believer, completely. I pray every morning of my life, and religion has always helped me to have that strength because it gives me the hope. I always feel tremendously sorry for people who do not believe.
Helene's mother-in-law, Lady Smith-Ryland, lives just round the corner, so to speak, on the estate.
It's large. It's not gigantic. It's not what I call those white elephants, which sometimes are very hard to keep. There are about probably 12 bedrooms and about 8 or 9 bathrooms.
Robin and Helene live in a more modest house 100 yards away. It's been decorated by Helene.
I wanted to give it warmth, first of all. Bring out all the wood. All the wood was painted white. Give it glamour. So I tried to give it the atmosphere of a warm, cozy house, which is done in a certain way, but on the other hand, you can come in with boots, dogs can walk in, there's no problem. We had about 18 housekeepers in 6 years. So that's
the bread sauce.
Bread sauce.
Come for the broccoli.
Great. Until now we have Mrs. Clark, and she's the housekeeper and the cook. But she is precisely what I wanted.
Do you think English people know how to treat their servants?
Well, I think they certainly don't treat them badly at all. But they treat them, I sort of see around, they seem to be so apologetical about anything they ask. They sort of say, oh, could you please? Oh, yeah, I'm so sorry, but is it possible? Oh, thank you, it's so kind. I mean, it goes on, and I said to myself, there's no way. I'm here for a week, and every time I ask for anything, I have to go to this whole serenade. That's not on. I always say, could you please, and thank you very much, and that sort of thing, period. Now, I don't expect to have to do a whole dance of the 18 veils. We have a new horse.
Really?
A new acquisition. I haven't seen him yet. Morning, Vicky. I want to see the new horse.
Yeah, I'm just about to ride
him. Is that him?
Yeah.
Oh, hi. You're my darling. You are my absolute darling.
Do you have much to do with horses before you married Robin?
The only sport I've enjoyed in my life was riding. And I've always had a passion for horses. But I suppose it runs in the family. My great-grandmother was an expert in horses. All her life was around horses. And I do love them. I don't like riding them anymore. I'm scared. Because I had very bad falls. But I do adore them. And we generally get along, don't we? I've always adored animals, most of all. He's a little bit calmer, I find. All the things that were sort of dormant in me, maybe from the stories I had from my childhood or what was in my blood somewhere.
You think so?
I wouldn't have fallen for him.
How are you? But you've had a good season, the shoot?
I'm very much pro-hunting. I think it's done very well in England. I think the atmosphere around it is marvellous. England is a country of traditions. And I find that this last sort of campaigns of trying to destroy hunting is destroying England.
Not surprisingly, the guests for dinner tonight are all hunting devotees.
He said that Lord Bathurst could have a private pack of hounds to hunt his end of the country. And the farmers had another pack of hounds to hunt the other end of the country.
We bought the house that belonged to the woman who was a recluse, who died and left her millions to the
treasury farm.
The treasury.
Oh, hang on, the woman here, and
yes,
she had incredible sort of satin underwear and things.
Right.
It was all in the newspaper.
Well, you haven't been for a while.
We were so disorganised. We never used to go to the laundry. So we used to ring Turnbull and ask every Monday morning and order seven shirts each to send.
This reminds me of the man who picked up his finger bowl and drank out of it.
That's actually what I'm getting.
So the host did the same and said, marvellous water, which is very good.
The class system in England, to me, is still a bit of a mystery. Being Russian, it's a bit different from here, in the sense that people who are very grand are always very simple. And I tend sometimes to find some of the people of bigger families in England to make a point of making you feel uncomfortable. Well, we were brought up exactly the opposite. The grander you are, the bigger you are, the simpler you are, and your task is to make people who are probably not brought up the way you were to feel at ease with you. That, to me, is nobility.
I say that Helene is part Fanny Bryce, part Elsa Maxwell, and very much Helene de Ludinghausen. A woman full of charm, bubbly, sparkling as a glass of the finest champagne, witty, terribly, terribly caring, terribly humane, lacking pretentiousness. There is nothing pretentious about Helene.
Come on, come with me.
She
come
is
here.
As
come here.
Wonderful, as wild, as stylish as that fabulous pig April over there at Church Farm that Robin gave her.
Oh, my April. Poor April. April, that was worse. I like the pace of activity. I like the fact of being constantly on the go. It keeps me alive.
Next week, the larger-than-life American from over there, who's doing rather well over here. Bob Peyton has a very British lifestyle because of the millions he's made from a very American dish, the deep pan pizza. Find out how Peyton's pizzas paid off.